Hello, I'm Mike Battaglia with J.D. Power. Today I'm joined by Thomas King, who is the president of the Data and Analytics Division at J.D. Power, and he is also our Chief Product Officer. So we went through the keynote this morning.
We did.
Very interesting situation in the industry right now. Yeah. I think the takeaway is on balance, pretty good.
That's right.
So I guess my first question, though, along those lines is, you know, if I'm an OEM in this environment, we see that sales effectively look like they're going to be flat this year, maybe a little bit down. So with all of my competitors out there, how do I succeed? What are some of the keys to succeed in 2020?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think there's almost a question before that, which is to first succeed, you've got to define what success actually means. And that might sound like a crazy thing to say, but you know, in these environments where you see lower volumes, higher prices, there are different ways you can be successful. For some manufacturers, it's going to be a little bit more cautious on production, but earning higher profitability and transaction prices. For others, it's going to be the opposite. So really heavy on volume and maybe trading off a little bit of that that profit and price opportunity. So I think that's step one. But at the end of the day, look, let's state the obvious. The keys to success remain great products, great customer experience. Now, inevitably, in some instances, it's hard to change that overnight. You know, so if you've got kind of your playbook in place for the year, I think then it becomes down to how do you actually choose to run the business. Mm-hmm. And you know, I think it's fair to say that all manufacturers have certainly put a lot of effort and had a lot of success in improving their operations. That said, there still remains enormous opportunity in terms of sales operations activities. And what I mean by that specifically is making sure that your incentives are as efficient and as effective as they can be, but also making sure that you've got the absolute right products in the right place at the right time. So if you can optimize that incentive spending and make sure that you've got desirable vehicle configurations in the right locations with the right amount of inventory, then there are quite literally billions of dollars of opportunity that even today are left untapped.
So and Doug Betts talked about that this morning, right? With the complexity that's still inherent in the configurations that are out on the market, and it just seems like there's such an enormous opportunity there to scale that back and not to provide less choice, but to provide the right choice.
That's right. That's right. And you know, it's not like this hasn't been an area of focus for manufacturers, but what has changed is there's now data sets that allow them to really bring the power of high quality, competitive information to the marketplace, and then use modern data science to actually unlock that potential from that very rich information. You know, we're talking about billions and billions of data points, which kind of makes any conventional analyst head explode, but with modern techniques, you really can embrace this stuff. And again, you know, the opportunity is enormous.
Yeah, it's amazing. So, kind of switching gears a little bit, you know, we see that there's a shift in the mix away from lower priced sedans to higher priced SUVs, which translates into higher monthly payments for consumers.
That's right.
So transaction prices are at an all-time high.
Yep.
How much more room do we have?
it's a great
And what
question.
Are we going to do about it?
Yeah, so I mean, I think transaction prices are at an all-time high, but let's keep in mind that when we talk about industry and transaction prices, it's an average of 17 million people on a total volume basis. Mm-hmm. And so it's important to disassemble the actions of an individual consumer versus the actions of the collective, right? And what we've actually seen is that the low end of the market has contracted, so there's fewer people buying the cheaper vehicles, mm-hmm. which drives the average up, mm-hmm. right? So that fundamentally tells you that, look, even though prices are at record levels, and they are frankly astonishing compared to where we were even 5 years ago, you can fundamentally feel a little bit more beneficial about that. I think the second big thing is, you know, you've got to think about the value story that the industry is providing to consumers. Mm-hmm. A lot of new product, probably, I think it's fair to say, the best product that there's ever been. And then also a lot of features and content that people are valuing. You know, I think if we all put our own personal perspective on buying a vehicle, if you've got a choice about buying a vehicle, it's kind of a traditional safety package mm-hmm. versus an advanced safety package. It's hard to argue with the idea of spending a little bit more money to guarantee or improve the personal safety of your family.
And not to mention infotainment and connectivity, the in-car experience has changed dramatically with new products, right?
You name it. And you know, those of us close to the industry have seen this thing evolve, you know, day to day, week to week, month to year. But for a lot of consumers, if they haven't been in market for 5 or 6 years, mm-hmm. I mean, the delta in the vehicles and what's available is frankly staggering. And I think that's why we can feel a little bit better about consumers' willingness to pay these mm-hmm. prices. Now, ultimately, eventually, you know, it's going to get out of control. And so inevitably, at some point, you will start to see some moderation there. But suffice to say, I think for now, we've still got quite a bit of runway. In fact, our outlook for the year for prices is basically a do-over in terms of growth from what we saw last year. So right around that 2 to 3% increase in prices.
And we probably, along those lines, we probably need to keep our eye on 84-month financing and longer-term financing. And now it's under control, but we just got to make sure that it doesn't start to get out of control.
That's right. Yeah, higher prices are great short-term for the industry. Question is, how are you getting there? If you're getting there just simply through pushing everyone into super long loans, that's obviously a real threat. You know, right now, I think the industry is basically doing it the right way. Loan terms are rising a little bit, but not out of control. Good discipline on subprime lending. So, you know, there is a real legitimacy to these prices. It's not, as the data shows, a one-time thing. You know, we've been on consistent price increases post-recession because of all the things we just talked about. Yep. So, you know, certainly let's hope it persists because it's really good news for manufacturers and you know, ultimately also helps retailers.
So kind of along these lines, you know, we have rising transaction prices, we have revenues up for OEMs, dealer profitability is still pretty solid. So, you know, the economy's good, the health of the industry's pretty good, and yet it feels like as we are out with clients on a regular basis, that there is this, I don't know if angst is the right word, or there's uncertainty, maybe is a better word, right, of where the industry is and where it's headed. Why do you think that there's this this uncertainty that kind of persists right now?
Yeah, I think there's two things. You know, we talked a little bit earlier about how everybody's been raising their games in terms of their operations, how they run business, and frankly, everybody's bringing their A game to the marketplace. And while the overall market is strong, you know, you don't succeed by default. So everybody is fighting hard to get the attainment of their objectives, whatever they may be. So I think that, you know, keeps people on their toes. But I think the second part is that, you know, the industry is on the cusp, some would say already in a significant transition. You know, big capital requirements from the shift to EV and autonomous, and a lot of uncertainty. And you know, that's doubly true when you take a global perspective. Right, so there's dynamics in the US, but when you think about some of the European legislation, for example, high degree of uncertainty. You know, if you talk about the UK government, you know, just recently talking about when there might be a ban on the sale of combustion engines, you know, that generates some anxiety. And of course, we do have a dynamic, you know, in certain parts of the world with the coronavirus, which is also uncertain.
I was going to ask you about that. Yeah.
Yeah. So obviously, a very tragic set of circumstances. You know, I think hard to predict how it's going to play out. I mean, I think the one thing that's fair to say is it will be a negative for the industry. The question is how negative, and that's going to be a function of do things continue to get worse or do they start to get better, and how long will the effects be felt for? Practically speaking, what we're talking about is disruption to supply chains. So, you know, are manufacturing facilities, both the vehicles and parts, up and running? Are they running at full capacity? And right now there is obviously some disruption, but it's really unclear you know, how that's going to play out. You know, to the extent things resolve quickly, then there could be minimal disruption. To the extent that they're extended, then you know, it's going to be a meaningful challenge.
And on balance, we have a little bit of room, right? Because the day supply, you know, within the across the United States right now is still fairly high. So
that's right. So there's a large number of units on the ground at dealerships. There is a supply of parts at warehouses and in manufacturing facilities. And you know, the timing of the events in China is such that you know, there was already some buffer built in. So I think you know, we won't, irrespective of how this thing plays out, really see any of the full benefit or full impacts until you know, maybe another month or two from now. But again, highly, highly uncertain, and certainly we hope the situation resolves quickly.
For sure. Thanks for your perspective. Appreciate it. Thanks, Thomas.
You're welcome. Thank you.